Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Associate Professor Dr. Wan Sabri bin Wan Hussein. On behalf of Student and Alumni Affairs, I would like to extend a very welcome to all of you. And we appreciate you taking your time to join us today. To kick off this morning program, I would like to introduce a bit about of our speaker for today. He's Mr. Ramco Monfils. Was the CEO of the Philip Group of Companies in Malaysia from 1994 until 1997, and became a president director of PT Philips Ralin Electronics in Indonesia, and also the chairman as a CEO of the Philip Group of Companies in Indonesia from 97 until 2001. And for the past 45 years in the industry, today he's here to share with us the history of a person from the office boy, finally made it to the top of the multinational company. Now, without further ado, please welcome Mr. Ramco Monfils.
Okay, I just go. Good morning, still good morning, eh? Yeah. I'm very honored to be here. But I'm also a little bit scared because I see a lot of people who most probably know more all of this than I do. I am not a universitarian. I started in the company serving coffee. I was doing that from my 15 years onwards. So when I retired, I was 45 years with Philips worldwide. And when I retired, I was Senior Vice President worldwide. I enjoyed my life because what I'm going to talk to you is about only my experiences. It's not from the books. Most probably things I tell are out of the books. You can follow it, but you can. What I have is not from any book. It's all from my own experience, and I really love what I do. My whole career was around people. And I discovered that in my career, people was the most important thing from the company. It was the biggest asset. It was not necessarily the product, it was the willingness of the people, it was their doing that makes us successful. So without further ado, let me try to do the introduction here. And I apologize for everything, for something which may go wrong. When I was 9 years old, my parents immigrated to Brazil. I was from Holland. I was from Holland. My parents immigrated to Brazil. I had no say in it because your parents go, you go. And when I was 10, this was Brazil. This is the flag from Brazil. We have a Brazilian here, by the way. when I was 10, my father got sick, very sick. And we had no income anymore. And as the oldest boy of the family, I started to work. My work on 10 years old was washing plates in restaurants and polishing shoes in hotels. I did that. I did a lot of other work. I did some work. We squatted a piece of land behind our house, which was not our land. Nobody knew about it, and we planted groceries and potatoes and whatever. And my brother and me became wholesaler of groceries when we were 11 and 12 years old. We were selling to the supermarkets. So then finally one man came to us and said, look, you should not lose your time there. Come to me, you sell everything to me, and I become your wholesaler. So we became in business with a wholesaler. Finally, when I was 15 years old, I decided to be more serious. And with the short pants and tennis shoes and a hole in my t-shirt, I went to the first company I saw in front in the center of São Paulo. I went to the 10th floor to the HR department and I said, I want a job here. And they look at me and they say, what do you know? I said, nothing, but I'm willing to learn. So that was the day they hired me in Philips. The next day, I was brought in a big room. There were all those coffee cans and and cars and people sitting there, hundreds of people sitting behind computers and all that kind of stuff. And my boss said, look, you see all those people there? I said, yes. Now go serve coffee to all those people. I looked at him and said, me serving coffee? No way. He said, then you are fired. I said, okay, now. That was the day I started. I started in Philips serving the coffee. And I remember I had a boss who was always yelling at me. Believe me, I deserved it. Believe me. He was always again and again yelling at me. And then sometimes I said, but boss, I didn't do anything. He said, that's for the next time you do something wrong. So he said, as long as you cannot serve coffee correctly, you will never go up in the company. So I finally learned how to serve the coffee, and they started helping me. They sent me to evening school. It was a big sacrifice, but I did it. And I passed several departments, and you became, because of all those things you do, you learn from experience. You don't learn it any from the books, but you learn from experience. This is me. When I was 18 years old, I started in 1956. Data de admission means data when you started. And this picture was taken in 1960. So that means that I started. Sorry?
50 years ago.
Yeah. Yeah. So I. That's what I started. I passed several departments. I worked in every department you can imagine. In the warehouse, in the canteen, and finally, after a long time, after learning all those things, I did a lot of mistakes, boys do. I even got fired twice. One for fighting. Another boy of my age, and we fighted, and we went for punches, and I was fired, the other boy was fired also, and my boss saved me. He came to the top of the department, to the company, he said, if this boy, he has a future. If he is fired, I resign. I never forgot this man. The other one was fired, I stayed still in the company. And many, many years, that was hunting me about, and many, many years, I did the same to another boy who was fighting in the company, and I saved him. This, because you should not forget your past. You should always, I know a lot of people who are always looking up, but you should sometimes look back. Where are you now and where you have been? Don't forget your past. It's one of the most important things I learned in my life. After I was working in the warehouse, and also what you have learned is not being arrogant. I was working in the house and I was in charge, as a young assistant already, to destroy materials which were obsolete. And I remember we had a big bench of microphones on the ground, which was those beautiful things you clip to the table and you're talking. And it was about 50 units, and I had the order to destroy them because the new model was already coming in. So I had all those people from the warehouse with big hammers coming and put a big circle in the warehouse ground, and they were hammering it all. And I was having a small hammer in my hand just to see if one escaped the death, and if one escaped, I was like this, having it also. But I didn't know there was one of the directors from Holland in that warehouse, and he saw that, and he took one of the good microphones still from the ground. He said, oh, nice. And he walked away with it, and he had to pass through me. I said, oh, sir, what do you have there? I said, microphone. He said, can I have it? So he gave it to me. I put it on the table, and I gave it back to him. He said, no, you can take it. He looks at me. He said, you're fired. That was the second time. That I learned never to take authorities which you don't have. I took authorities, but I didn't have. What I should have done is make the report. And then that's it. What your bosses do with it is something different. Anyhow, after 8 years, I was working in the audit department. Believe me, that was one of the most boring jobs I have ever had in my life. I didn't like it. I had to check figures which others already had made. There was nothing initiative, nothing there. And that was when I asked to be transferred to the commercial department, because those people, corporate people, there you knew a lot of new people, so I wanted that. It was refused, because my boss looked at me and said, you are a brilliant auditor. You will be very good in it, and I will help you to take the decision. You are not going to move. That was the day I resigned. I wanted to be commercial. So, next day I was called back on the company. And the big boss looked at me and said, "We never made a good Brazilian out of you. We never, you have failed as being a Brazilian. Now we're going to send you back to your country of origin, to Holland. Let's see if they can make a good Dutchman out of you." Well, they also failed. I'm not a good Dutchman. Anyhow, that is one how my life started my international life started. Oh, you know this picture. My international career, my first post, of course, was in Holland, where I worked in three departments. And not very important what happens there, studying, radio, TV, small domestic appliances, and light. Today, Philips worldwide is not having all those departments anymore. The only thing what they have still is light and medical systems, and maybe some small domestic appliances. The rest is all done. Philips is back to a very small setup. The most important thing that happened to me in Holland was I met my wife. And I am still married with her. And we are now married this year, 50 years. And when I tell my friends I'm married 50 years, they say, with the same woman? I'm still happy, really. Okay, after the Netherlands, I went to Portugal, where I became responsible for the overseas territories. That means Portugal was in that time in charge of Angola, Mozambique, Azores, Madeira, Macau, Timor, Cape Verde Islands. And I became responsible for all these territories. When I came there, I was green as grass. And I didn't know where to drop dead. And a young man, well, not so young anymore, but a black man took me from the airport. He was from Angola. And he said to me, "Do you want to go to the office or to your hotel? But first, because office is a mess anyhow, so come tomorrow." I said, "No, I want to see the mess." We came to the office and he explained to me, and really, it was a mess. And I said, "Why you have not done anything?" He said, "Well, I'm the second in command here, but the boss is never here, and we are not allowed to do anything. We have no authority, we have no anything. So, and by the way," he said, "before you know, in next week I will resign, because that post that you're going to take should be mine." He was very honest. And I looked at him and said, he talked with me the afternoon, and I said, "He was good, he was really good." The man spoke 7 languages, all fluently. So that means the man was indeed very good. And I said, "I need him. If I don't keep him, I will finish here." So I talked to him and I looked him in the eye and I said, "You are a very dishonest man." He looks at me and says, "Why?" I said, "Because you have not even given me a chance." And he looks at me and he said, "Nobody ever accuses me of being dishonest. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to stay 6 months. And after 6 months, I leave." Well, the 6 months passed and we became big friends and we worked very good together and we made a success out of it. And we started in Angola something, a very nice activity, which was, and some of you know what it is, it's barter deals. This means we were not using money to sell products, with products against products. So we were selling to Angola and Mozambique and other African territories, we were selling powder milks and lamps, because I had to put some lamps in this, from Philips, I was an employee from Philips, powder milk, and they were exporting coffee back to Europe. That deal, we did it for several years. Then I came back from Africa and they said, "We need to give him some experience in Portugal itself." So I became a branch manager. And that was in Porto, Portugal. Porto is a very nice place. They have port wine and all that kind of stuff. But they are famous for that export. That I learned more about people. And for instance, there I learned also to give everybody deserves a second chance. I had my second chance, well, I had my third chance even, But everybody deserves a second chance. I had, I think, the top men, salesmen from the company. One day, my manager comes in, and today I'm going to fire Mr. Juan Lopez. I said, whoa, no. He is a very good salesman. No. He said, yeah, because he's cheating the company. I said, what is he cheating for? Well, if I go from Porto to Coimbra with a trip, he declares 150 kilometers to go and 150 kilometers, and he charges it for the company. He said, so, is that all? He said, yes. So, but I have to give an example. I said, well, I will handle it. So we called in the man, and I said, Mr. Juan Lopez, are you willing to do something for me? Yes, Mr. Monfils, of course. I said, can you do me a favor? This afternoon, you take your car to the garage. No, nothing wrong with my car. I said, yeah, there's something wrong. Your kilometer teller is not working properly. Because when I go from Porto to Coimbra, it's only 75 kilometers. When you go, your kilometer teller indicates 150. Because that is what you're declaring. So go there, adjust the kilometer teller, and say, oh yes, Mr. Lopes. Of course, he never did it again. Second chance. What I learned is leave the door open for the escape. If somebody is good and he deserves that chance, leave the door. Don't give him the possibility to remediate it himself. That was one of my big lessons with these people. After that, I went to Taiwan. Now, Taiwan, I was there for 3 years, and I didn't speak Chinese.
No.
And the worst thing is, I also don't speak Bahasa. And I tell you why I don't speak Bahasa, because whenever in Philips I started to try to speak Bahasa, the people said, boss, we don't understand you. Speak English, more easy. So I honestly, I tried. Honestly, I did try. Anyhow, after in Taiwan, we had the only nice thing in Taiwan was I don't know if you know an article in Philips, it's called Philly Shaves. Philly Shaves is a shaving machine, electric shaver. And we produce in the world about 10 million of those units a year. So I came to Taiwan and I said to my sales manager, why are you not selling shavers here? He looks at me and he shows his face like this. I said, what are you trying to tell me? He said, we Chinese have no beard. I said, no, but I see some here. He said, no, that we cultivate. Anyhow, we made a campaign where we started to selling Philly Shave as a status symbol. You know, the mind is very powerful, and when it is status, people like to be part of it. So we made a very powerful advertising for the television where you see a young executive going to his work, shaving very happily in the car to his work, in a luxury car, of course, shaving, and then everybody happy with him. Believe it or not, we also, after that, we paid 100 gentlemen to go to the work in the morning with Philly Shave, in the car, driving to the office, shaving themselves. After 1 month, we had thousands of people shaving themselves in the car, going to the office, because it wasn't an article, it was a status symbol, you have to. The worst was, it better, people on the motorcycle came to the office shaving on the motorcycle. Then, of course, then you have to create demand. So what we did, we sent a lot of people to shops. We paid them for that, and we asked them for, look, it's Father's Day, what I give to my father, I want to buy a Philly Shave. Shop had no Philly Shave. Many questions, you create demand. The owner of the shop says, oh, I need better, I take some stock, because people come in and you ask for buying it, they want to have it. Demand, create the demand. Yeah. So, then finally the Philly Shaves were in the shop. Now we have to get it out. So now you need the cooperation of the people in the shop to sell it. Otherwise, nobody's going to do anything. So we started a campaign where we paid housewives, with trolleys, going to the shops and saying, I want to buy a present for my husband. Now, the people of the shops knew that if they would offer a Philly Shave as a present for the husband, they would have a special price. So sometimes every client coming in, oh, maybe one of those I can get my price. So it was successful. In the first year, we sold 250,000 units in Taiwan. People, no beard. After Taiwan, I went to Argentina. Argentina was the biggest difficulty of my life. My predecessor was kidnapped in Argentina. He was kidnapped for 36 days, and he was threatened by death several times. And I came in when he was finally released. Of course, the company paid, I think, $2 million to release him. And I came in. But I came in, I had to do a complete reorganization. And immediately after the first month of reorganization, my life was threatened. And my wife was even called home, say, your husband is not coming home this evening. I was going to office every day, different routes. Of course, I had a driver. The driver was armed, and I had a car behind me with a man with a machine gun. And those things helped. Anyhow, finally, after those people start threatening me by phone, and don't get angry with these people. These people have their own ideology, they know all those things. And they say, yeah, but you have to stop this organization. I say, why? If I don't do an organization, we had 3,000 people there. I said, if I don't do this organization, 500 people go on the street by saving the company. Otherwise, if I don't do it, the company whole goes down and 3,000 people on the street. You guys have to tell me what I have to do. So I put them, my problem, I gave them. And they started to say, yeah, maybe. So they left me in peace. We did the reorganization, it was very well done. And the company started increasing again. And I give you one nice example. The company was making losses many years. And the year I came, we had a budget negative for the company all together of negative 1% loss. I went to the head office in Holland and I said, what can we do? What are we ready to give our employees if we make profit? So what do you want? I said, I want 10% for the profit for the company. You are not going to make any profit anyhow. So 10% of the profit we make, for the net profit, I want to distribute it to the company, to the employees. They said, okay, no problem. We made 8% positive instead of 1 negative. And I had to pay 8 months salary bonus to all the people in the end of the year. And of course, when I was in the middle of the process, the head office phoned me and said, no, we have to put a top on this, maximum 4 months. I didn't obey, I didn't follow. I paid the owed 8 months and I said to the head office, fire me. Well, I was not fired. So, but sometimes when you give your word, you cannot change the rules of the game during the game. You have put the rules, then you have to follow those rules. If you change the rules during the game, it is not going to work. That was one of my experiences in Argentina. After Argentina, I went to Mexico. Argentina was 6 years. Together, Mexico was 6.5 years. Mexico was a very difficult town because I'm happy I see some ladies here in the room. Mexico, no lady managers, only the men, the big machos. The big machos. And when I finally promoted the first lady in the company, I got a revolution. It was terrible. They made the life of the poor lady so miserable that she went out of her room of her own employees crying. Because they made her life so miserable. I remember, I called her back in my office. And I said, the next time you cry in office, I fire you. I put you there, now you stand for it. And the first meeting, when she had her first meeting, I was there. Just to make sure, just to make sure. So that was the first time that the ladies are coming up. Really. And they are equal than us. And look, sometimes they're better than us, but we don't want to argue that. I must say, if you ask me honestly, if I want to have a lady as a boss, I don't know if I like it. And then finally, when they made me this question, I said, yes, No problem, but she must be very good. Because, see, we don't, I don't know, there's still that still machismo, Latin America, I am from there also, that feeling. But I promoted something different, and I show you later what I did. For instance, in Argentina, it was an interesting, but the first time I promoted a lady to the, by the way, it was finance. Ladies are very good in finance. After that, I was meant to go to Venezuela. That was the Venezuela not of today. That was the nice Venezuela. Still beautiful, nice climate, economically doing well. But before Venezuela, they had this problem in Curaçao. Curaçao is in the front of Venezuela. They say, you go there for Curaçao, see if you want to integrate it in Venezuela company when you take over the company in Venezuela. I got 6 months for that. In 1 month, I made my report and I went out of there because there was nothing there. It's a nice place to be, but there was nothing there. And I said, don't give it to an agent and forget the whole thing. Because even if you give it to an agent, the turnover will be the same. There is nothing you can improve there. Then finally, Venezuela. Venezuela was very interesting. When I arrived, we had one manager lady. When I left, we had 7. And they were good. Really, they were good. The Venezuela, I got more managers, and there I got my first operation of joining country. The problem is, we have, there for the first time I was confronted with a word which you called positive sabotage. Have you ever heard about the word sabotage? You know what it is. But you heard about the word positive sabotage. Positive sabotage is saying something which you make, you want others to believe, but you know will never happen and cannot happen. That means you give an idea, and then finally you know that idea will not work through. But you have shown that you are very positive. Look, I have given the idea. Committed. I'm committed. No, you're not committed because you know it cannot happen. You know it will not work. Which means that is the first time I was confronted with. Then I had to join Venezuela and Colombia. Venezuela was having 11% selling expenses. Colombia was having 30% selling expenses. Finally, when we did the whole exercise, suddenly Colombia came back to 18% and we came up to 18%. So what we did, they didn't do anything. They just took our benefit from our country, put it in the middle, divided by 2, and then you had the new selling space, but nothing was done. I torpedoed that thing because the people were saying that I was not positive. But they came with beautiful ideas, but it was all sabotage positive. It could not happen. And by the way, you have to know something about, how you call it, about the local costumes. Venezuelans and Colombians don't go very well together. They don't do it. Then finally, welcome to paradise. Let me tell you something. I, many times, mainly to the younger generation, your country may not be perfect, but it is more perfect than all the countries I have been in. It's very important for you. Sorry that I'm a foreigner, but I will tell you that with the whole my heart. This is a beautiful country. Really, it's a beautiful country. And I'm very proud to be here. I'm a PR, I'm a permanent resident. And I got that because the big boss from the company here, the big boss from the country signed for my PR when I left. I said, I want to come back, but I don't want to go to Holland, and he signed for my PR. And I'm very proud he did. So, Malaysia was a great experience. I will go to it. First, then, after Malaysia, I went to Indonesia. I stayed 4 years in Indonesia, and I came back to Malaysia. I retired, and I came back to Malaysia to stay here for the rest of my life. So, let me tell you, even if you think there are complaints, Medicare here, I talk in private medical care, not government. But Medicare here is really much better than all the countries I have been. Australia, Holland, Germany. It's much better. Here you go to your own, you choose your own physician, you choose your, look, when they discovered cancer in my right kidney, I went to the specialist the next day, boop, 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 1 week later I was operated. One kidney less, but I was operated, and here I am, I'm still alive. And when I had a problem with my heart, 1 week, solved. Back in the hospital, operated very fast. Oh, by the way, and compared with prices in the rest of the world, very cheap. Then, by the way, culture here is marvelous. It's so nice that all the different cultures are living here together. It's so beautiful. I go to Hari Raya, I go to all those parts. I live in a Muslim neighborhood. All my neighbors are Muslims. But I was invited in all the open houses. I gained a few kilos because the food is very good. Okay. Indonesia, not much to tell about it. I did not like so much Indonesia. My wife was always sick there, and I had to transport her several times, or to Malaysia for treatment, or to Singapore. Then, just to tell you something about Malaysia, is when I was in Philips, and I believe my success was not because I was the most clever of everybody. Absolutely not. My success was because I had the right people doing the right things and being motivated. I did a lot for that. My most important thing was keeping the people motivated to make things happen for the company. I was not the most clever. I had employees for me, working for me, much more intelligent than I was. But what I was able to do was keeping them together, getting all the noses in the same direction, and all joining for one common goal, which was the result of the company. Now, I believe in people power, and that was one of the things I implemented here. Also, another thing is what I always told my employees, I said, you are not important. If you think that you are already on the top of the ladder, you are just beginning. If you finish your university, you have just started. You are not, don't think, oh, and if you know the most important people in the country, you are not going to be successful just because you know them or you have been with them. And I can show you a few pictures from this. Involve people in the management indirectly. Involve them also in the charity from the company. Do all those kind of things together with them. And then look. Look what the employees from the company did. They created two kindergartens for the poor. One in Kuala Gangsa and one in Kuala Gangsa and the other was in Batuara. Thank you. I'm old man, I forget things, you know. It's written there, but I was not reading it. You have an advantage on me again. So, and this thing, all the painting and the floor and thing was done, the tables was done by own employees. But on Saturdays and Sunday, we're going there, putting up the school. Of course, Philips paid for the material, which was, but we got full cooperation from the government to do that. Another thing is keep your people involved. We made a brass band in Philips, a really good one. The employees, all people, were working for the company, playing an instrument. And I remember that I was in my office, and five people came in, and they say, boss. I want to tell you something about boss. Eh? I don't like boss so much. Manager is good, boss is not good. The boss yells at you, but the manager manages. So, but boss, we have an idea. For the Philips Club, we want to make a small group playing music. Yeah, that's good, great. Come back, what is the plan? How many people you have? Oh, we have five, only us. So, no. Come back when you have 100. The next day they came back, they say, now we have 100. I said, okay, what is the plan? Okay, we want to make a brass band. How many of you can read music? Only five of us. So how are you going to make a brass band and you cannot read music? Oh, we hire a teacher. Who's going to pay the teacher? The company. Anyhow, the year before, we had a great year. Because if today you are angry with me or angry with Astro because they don't have the right films, it's my fault. I put Astro on the map in Malaysia. You have Astro because of me. That means we had a great year. And I said, how much is going to cost this? And they give me a budget, 400,000 ringgit for musical equipment. I looked at the pay budget, I signed, I said, there you are. Go, keep me informed. 3 minutes later, my financial manager run into my office. You signed what? I said, well, I signed 400,000 ringgit for music. Are you out of your mind? I said, no, I'm not out of my mind. We have to keep the people motivated. He said, have you permission from Holland to do this? I said, of course not. He said, why not? I said, if I ask, they say no. So we don't do that. He said, yeah, but I have to report to Holland. I said, no problem. I give you a letter, handwritten letter to you, that if you get in trouble because of that, I tell you that I have overruled you, and that's it. So no problem. He looks at me and said, my goodness, if you are taking that risk, I'm with you. I don't want the letter. And we went up with it. Nobody ever discovered. But they only discovered 1 year later. Finally, the people came to me and said, boss, we want to play in the Merdeka Day. We want to march in Merdeka Day. Oh, I said, great. And I was having the idea that Merdeka Day in front of the post office, the old rail station. I said, oh, that's nice. The big flag, I said, good. What I didn't know, when I say yes, it was in Kota Kinabalu. Well, I said yes, I could not go back. We sent 110 people to Kota Kinabalu Hotel 1 week. 1 week, they had to march, of course, paid by the company. So my big boss phoned me. He said, hey, Remco, I am in Singapore. I hear some rumors. You have about 110 people in Kota Kinabalu on the account of the company doing what? I said, well, we're playing for Merdeka Day. You know, it's good. He said, I am in Singapore. Tomorrow I fly because I want to see it. You better be in the same plane with me and we go there. And it better be good. So I fly in. We arrived at the hotel. Of course, I phoned him. And when we arrived with the taxi at the hotel, the whole Philips brass band was in front, in full uniform, in front of the hotel. Playing, pa-pa-pa-pa. And welcome, Mr. Sluiter. That was the boss. And he said, oh, this looks very good. Is it as good as that tomorrow? I said, no, tomorrow is better. So the next day we marched. We were playing and marching. And before us was one group marching, and behind us was another group. But the people did very well. It was very motivating. We were on the national TV. And I wrote a letter to all the rest of the staff. Please, the week that those people are away, nobody get leave. Nobody get, please, sick, because we get in trouble. We get in trouble. Nobody was sick. Everybody was there. So it was very nice, and we did only one little thing, which was not allowed, that when we passed the big stand from the government with all the ministers and the national television on it and playing and marching, at the middle of the stoop of our group came a sign out. Writing, Philips, let's make things better. On national television, no escape, it was there. My boss said, oh, you already paid for it, that's okay. But I was very heavily criticized because that was not allowed. But sometimes you have to do things which... Okay, our group introduced the Malaysia Customer Day. Our employees, even finance, even went to the street seeing customers. That means we stationed people from the commercial department and from the factories in dealers just to show what is a client. So we trained them for a little bit and then what is it? To see what is the world, not I do my work and nothing else, but it's important. The client is not important. I had to teach the people the client is the most important thing we had. No clients, company goes down. I had a big sign in the door saying, in this company, nothing happens without a sale. That is, just to give an example, I had a financial manager who coming into my office and said, that salesman who has hardly any education, he has no university, no nothing, he makes more money than I do. I said, yes. He said, I went to university. I have all this, and he makes more money than I. I said, yeah, man, he must be a very good salesman. He said, I said, yeah, but it's not fair. I said, well, I tell you what's not fair. You take that big baseball player in the United States, big, dirty, and he has a piece of wood in his hand, and he hits the ball, they throw a ball at him, and they hit the ball out of the park. And they pay him millions of dollars for it. And you think that is fair? Of course it's not fair. It's market value. So I said, you want to have the job of the salesman? I transfer you to the sales department. Let's see if you can survive. He said, no, I want to stay. It's, we have to consider people as in the market value, not only what they have from the diplomas and all that kind of stuff. Now, to be successful, I invented something in the company which is called multiplex organization. What we did is the worst thing that can happen in your company, the worst thing that happened in your company is I'm only paid for this job. I don't do anything else. My job description only indicates this. So I'm paid for this, and if you ask me, that's not my work. I don't do it. Everything may go wrong in your company. Everything may go wrong, but we don't do it because I'm not paid for that. Now, what I create is an ambient of people saying we have to do more than just simply our job. We have to do more. Just little things. I walk to the company, a phone goes. I hear it three times ring, I look, there are three tables there. Two tables sitting with people, and one saying nobody, most probably toilet or sweets. And I said to the other one, I say, I pick up the phone myself, say hello. And the first guy who passes by me, he said, it's for you. He picks up and says, oh, take the address, take the name, and tell the people that you will call back. And what I had to tell this man, is the next time I pass here and the telephone rings, and you don't pick up the phone, you're fired. Guess what? It worked. It went to the whole company. Any phone was ringing in the company, everybody jumping on the phone. It worked, really. And sometimes you have to tell people that there is more than only your job. There is much more than that. Okay, I started an organization, a new movement, which is called Multiflex. Now, people are always looking up. Again, I want people to look back. Look, always be looking up. It's not important. Is it for the company? No. I want promotion. I want promotion. I want go more. This is, I call it the rat race. Now, to be in a multiflex organization, you need perfect people, flexible people. You need, in Europe, we call it a sheep with five legs. Four legs is not enough. I need something more from people. Yeah. Five legs or something else. Yeah? Then you need to be able to operate at multi-level. That means you are not the orchestra leader anymore alone. You have to be able to play the first violin and the second violin as well. Don't be only, I am the boss, I don't have to do anything. No, you have to know something more. You have to play that first violin and the second violin as well. You are the boss of the orchestra. Look, this man here. But he has to be able to play those instruments. You have to be multifunction. You have to be prepared to do something more than only what is on your job description. Look, this man is talking several instruments at the same time. We had too many chiefs, no Indians. We have too many generals. You see all those generals there, and that poor soldier marching there, he has to win all the wars. And we had too many bosses there. Now, here we have the saying, less chiefs and more Indians. That is, you see, the big Indians are on the top of the hill, and that one goes for battle down there, and the other one looking down, how is going to be slaughtered? It's not work only if you go all together. Everybody goes for battle. Another thing is teamwork. It's a beautiful word. Everybody talk about teamwork. We are a team, we are doing. And look, on the moment that you put the teamwork on paper, oh, it's beautiful. Everybody wants to be a team player. But then comes reality. We carry the boat all together to the river. But then comes reality. And the reality is a little bit different because everybody has his own agenda. There we're going to row everybody in his own difference, and the boat doesn't move. Some forwards, some backwards, it doesn't move at all. Because there is no unity. It should work, of course, like this, all the noses into the same direction. Now we have a lot of personal behavior. And though you must have your own way of looking at any situation, you must have the flexibility to adapt your own way to the company, cause you are working for. Not your own, but necessarily for the company. You are working for a company, you have to give that unity in the company. It's good to follow role models. I have a few. In Malaysia, I have a few. For instance, Rafid Aziz was a role model for me. Why? Because she was so terribly outspoken. And she's terribly outspoken. So sometimes I scratched my head. I said, ooh, a little bit too much. But she was very much outspoken. And that I appreciated that. And I admired her for that. Then, see, I'm also an admirer of Jeffrey Cha. Why? Because he is very open in his views. And even I remember one of this, Jeffrey Cha, yeah, and some way. And when they asked him in his question and answers, he said, can you please tell us why we have not enough entrepreneurs in our? We have always, from every 10 entrepreneurs, after 5 years, there is only two left. And after 10 years, there's only one. What do we have to do to be more entrepreneurial? You know what he answered? He said, I'm happy you are not all entrepreneurials, because if you would all be entrepreneurials, I don't have employees. It's a fact. Then I have one thing is always have to be in the back of your mind. What you want to be, a boss or a manager? Well, the manager says it. You have to manage people. You have to put them together. You have to make the liaison between people, and you're working with them. I wrote just an article for this magazine. I don't know if you know, I've seen it once. Just where I say, everybody needs allies. And in that magazine, I say, you are not living like Tarzan in the jungle. There is much more than that. You are living in a society where you live with people and you have to handle people who are not necessarily your friends, but are completely different from you. And you have to make them united, and that is a real management. And the thing is, rule number one, the boss is always right. Let's go. Rule number two, but the boss is not always right, automatically rule number one comes into practice. So it's not working that way anymore. I give a lot of examples for people. There is a saying, who angers loses. You anger, you lose the plot already. If you are in a discussion and you get angry, forget it, you have already lost. It doesn't start the way. Only the people who keep calm win a discussion. People who get angry never win. Even if you are correct and others are wrong, be diplomatic and respectful. That's one of the things I learned in my life. Do not only look ahead of you, but look back and be happy. Because where you have been and where you are now. Look, this is a few of my diplomas which I got from other countries. This is from Mexico. This is from Argentina. This is from Venezuela. And this is from Holland. In Holland, I can call myself Sir. This is, it's very high in the condecoration in Holland, given by the Queen, because, and it was given by me for the many work I did for the Dutch community in other countries. I, for instance, in any country where I was, not except for Malaysia, I was the head of the Chamber of Commerce. So I was doing that because in Malaysia I had no time for it, because I was too busy. But I did it in many, and I got that congregation because of that. Now, what I tell people, you are not important. I have always people trying to be more important than others. And I had one manager, and one day I had enough of it. I invited him for lunch, and we went to a cemetery. He said, "What are you doing here?" He said, "Look around. Look around. Nice, peaceful wind, birds singing." He said, "What do you see?" I said, "What? Very peaceful." He said, "Do you hear anybody complain he is more important than anybody else?" He said, "No." I said, "I hope you learn this is not the case. You are equal. It's all so limited. You are here in this world. You are equal than anybody else. Sometimes your function gave you a little bit more authority than others. But don't try to be superior than anybody else. Nobody complains here." So, and he said, "Look, here, even Mr. Churchill is there. He's not complaining. He was very important. But you hear him complain? No." So, one other thing in the companies. Too many kingdoms. I can give you a few examples in Malaysia. I have seen a few big companies. My goodness. Everybody has his own agenda. People don't talk to each other. Organizations, even on the same floor, don't talk to each other. It's very bad, and that's the reason why we have too many employees to do many things, which is nothing, to equal to nothing. The other is too many kingdoms. Nobody, it is not one unity for the company. Everybody has his own agenda. Everybody has his own importance. Allow people to make mistakes. Hopefully not too big. This was a big one. This is a big one. But allow them to make mistakes. Because if people don't make mistakes, if I hire people, I ask my favorite question to them is, "Do you make mistakes?" If the man says, or the woman, "No, I don't make mistakes," I don't hire him, because he or lies or he's not working. You have to make mistakes if you work. Now, don't be a medal stealer. It's always the same. When you are in charge, you get all the blames, but you have to share the success. That is the ungrateful part of being a manager. It's truth, because, as you will see, the soldiers general win the battles, but the generals get credit for them. That was Mr. Napoleon Bonaparte who said that. Motivation and rewards. The old way to succeed is 10% inspiration and 90% transpiration. It is really, if you say, "I have studied and now I have things going," I see so many people opening a business in this country and they say, they spend a lot of money. "I have the restaurant, I have a kitchen, I have tables, beautiful, installed, everything, cost me, I don't know." And then comes the real problem. "Oh, I need a chef, a cooking chef. I cannot find one. I need employees, I need servants. Oh, I forgot, I need parking lots." And all those kind of things people forget, because they are young, they are eager, and they put in the money from the most probably from the parents, and they start a big business. And then it does not happen. And that's the reason why so many small entrepreneurs, they start full enthusiasm, but they don't make it. Because you have to think before you start. I want to tell something about evaluation. Now, this is an example typical of what I told before. This is the man who hits the ball out of the park and gets millions of dollars for it. He has not even finished his lower school, but he makes millions of dollars. So this is what we call market value. And when that manager complained with me, I said, look, you think that if I can hit the ball out of the park like him, I would be sitting here? No, I would be hitting the ball out of the park. But I cannot, and he can. It's a question of, don't forget, it's always market value. Now, careful also with this one. People get promoted in the companies to their grade of incapacity. They are very good on this level, they get promoted, and suddenly they are failure. They don't know how to cope with the new higher job. They want to be there, but sometimes it's good to be honest with people. You have reached your limit. And no, they will be very unhappy, but you have to do it in a way that they don't feel so happy. It's the same like when you evaluate people, and I give you one example. Certain way, one day I had to give salaries increase about over the border, average 10%. So I give all the managers, said, look, 10% over the border for your employees. So somebody get one, somebody get 10, somebody get 5, whatever. Then when I judge the manager myself, and one of the managers, I gave him a 4%, he was very angry with me. And I said, why? He said, because even the cleaning woman got 9%. She reports to me. So my staff get 9% and I get only 4. And I had to explain the basic of the curve of Gauss. When you get on the top of your capacity, there is only one way. You can go stabilize and then you go down. And there is for that is, of course, you have to, the older managers, they get that frustration many times. That's the reason why I'm writing now an article for this magazine, but it will only be published next year, from how to motivate the motivators. So many times in companies, but managers with very old age already, 2 or 3 years before their retirement, they get completely demotivated because they are sidelined. They're still there, only receiving the salary, no increase, and they're not doing anything. These people we have to use because they are the best we have. They have all the knowledge. We have to use them for the younger generation. We have to use them as mentors for the, but we have to know how to do that. No, I'm happy to see ladies here. If we say that ladies are not successful, look at this one. She is having, she was now in Yahoo, she is in Yahoo, and she came from, where she came from? From Google, I think she came. And she was a top man from Yahoo, top woman from Yahoo. And now Yahoo is being sold to a company called Verizon or something like that. Verizon. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. And this lady will get millions of dollars until the end of her life. And she's very successful because she sold the company, or they sold the company, and she's getting rich for the rest of her life. And she's a very successful woman. Another thing is hiring. You hire people. Let me tell you, what I did sometimes is not very professional. When I hire a manager, I put him, my office is here, I put him in the corridor waiting for me, and I ask my secretary to serve him a coffee. Now I look how he says thank you to her, or just take the coffee, it's her obligation. That's one thing, all the humility. Then when he's sitting with his coffee, I tell my secretary, send the man in. Now then I look to the window of my office, I look how he comes. If he still continues drinking his coffee, then comes out and brings up like this to my office, he may be the champion of everything, but I don't take him. That is called body language. I know it's nothing sophisticated, but it's called body language. So then, of course, you have to make this choice between the man who knows everything and the man who knows less, but she's very eager. Now you have to make the choice between the eager beaver and the man who knows everything. Many times I go for the eager beaver. He wants that job. He really wants the job, and he is willing to do anything for it. Not the other man who says, okay, I already know everything. I'm the last Pepsi Cola before I go into the desert. That means I'm your salvation. That's not good for the company, that spirit. So you have to, the hiring is a very, now look, you know this, the grass of the neighbors is always greener than the grass in your own garden. You see, this poor cow, he has grass here on the left side, but no, the grass there is more delicious, it's more... So, what I'm trying to tell also the younger generations, don't job hopping too much. Job hopping, as an experienced manager, I never took job hoppers. I look into this file, I said, okay, 6 months there, 7 months there, 1 year here, I don't take him. Because I know that he's in my company, he is already looking for the next job and not even sitting down. So that means that is the kind of, the grasp of the, so I always say, sometimes where you are, it's better to stay where you are. When you hire people, don't look only at appearances. Look, the man on the left side here looks very well dressed, very well, like me, tired, kind of thing. But, and then we may make the mistake, look, this guy, sneakers. You know who he is, isn't he? He's very successful, very successful. Yeah, so you hire for the high tech or whatever, you would hire this one, but you don't know if you're going to look for his nice clothes and everything, so don't make that mistake. Also, letters of application, people, recommendation letters, that's something. Everybody can write a beautiful recommendation letters. You have a friend, can you write a, oh yes, beautiful, romantic, beautiful. But recommendation letters is not enough. You have to see what they do in their work. You have to show something what you have done in your own work. Look, these people, of course, four different candidates, don't hire them. Turn left, you go right. Oh, the crack-resistant cement. You see that in the... Oh, now, my favorite is this one. When you come at the machine, there's a tree there. Oh, I go around it, so... And, of course, you cannot read because school is not the way you write it down. So, marketing, entrepreneurship. That's the example I gave to you earlier. People start a business. Now, what you would like to be? You want to be in this restaurant, the owner of the restaurant, where nobody is, luxury, beautiful. Or you want to be in this, look, where the owner is serving the food and we're running around again, the customers. That's the business. That's how people have to start. People want to start sometimes already on the top of the ladder. I want to be big. You have to start here to eventually one day become there. I want to tell one part. In life, you will be confronted with failure and success. On the success, we have to build. And from the failures, we have to learn. Problems are there always to be solved, always. In fact, the problem must be considered as a challenge. And if we address it, it will make us stronger, much stronger and better for whatever lays ahead of us. People say, if you address problems, you get stronger all the way, all the time, over and over again. Life is riding a bicycle. Keep on pedaling, you will not fall. If you stop pedaling, there you go. Life is like in the bicycle. Keep up pedaling, you will not fall. Keep up the hard work and you will succeed. Keep up on doing good and you will feel happy. As my wife always signs off her emails, she signs, peace be with you. My son, the filmmaker, he signs off his emails, love and tolerance. And I will sign up from you with my wish to you to be happy and successful. Thank you very much.